100 years ago this week, as the Ottoman Empire was disintegrating, thousands of Armenians were rounded up and deported or executed. It was the beginning of a mass elimination of Armenian Christians from what is modern-day Turkey, killing an estimated 1 million and driving millions more into exile. Today, some 7 million Armenians live outside the tiny country of Armenia. Armenian-American photographer Scout Tufankjian spent 2 years photographing and interviewing them in more than 20 countries, from Ethiopia to India, from Brazil to the United States. They're the subject of her new book, There Is Only the Earth, Images from the Armenian Diaspora Project. Tufankjian sat down with NewsHour's chief foreign affairs correspondent Margaret Warner in our New York studio to talk about the project.
Scout Tufankjian, thank you for joining us and talk about this fascinating book.
Thank you.
Now, what drew you to this project?
So when I was a kid growing up in Massachusetts, and I'm going to show you a picture, I spent weekends with my grandparents who are in the book. There's my beautiful grandmother and my grandfather who has got a dog and a goat, as one
does. From 1948.
Exactly. So I spent weekends with my Armenian grandparents, and we would go from house to house, visiting their friends, drinking some Armenian coffee or some tea, and I would go through the Armenian magazines and newspapers that were inevitably on the coffee table, and I would search for kind of glimpses of myself in, you know, an Argentinian soccer player or a Parisian schoolgirl, and I was always looking for, you know, the answer to this question, you know, what do I have in common with these kids? Is there any connection between our people, or have the kind of differing paths taken by our refugee grandparents and great-grandparents really changed us?
And so what did you find? I mean, is there a collective spirit?
Oh, definitely. It's actually hard to define, and as a photographer, I kind of tried to define it in images, which is what this book is, but there is a thread that ties this kid in Paris blowing bubbles at at a wedding to, you know, this girl in Armenia, in the Republic of Armenia, who's a traditional dancer, to this Armenian girl in India who is experiencing monsoon season for the first time. There is this thread that ties people together. Is it the religion? You know, is it the language? Is it the schools? Is it the organizations? Or is it something kind of more ephemeral? Which is what I actually think it is. It's, you know, I talked to a woman in Argentina and she said it's like belonging to a club that's invisible to everyone but the members. And I think that has a lot to do with the things that tie us together. It's not the genocide. Armenians don't define themselves by the genocide. It's this kind of sense of survival.
So you have a number of religious photographs here. Talk to us about how important the common Armenian Christianity is and how that transcends these continents.
Okay. For one thing, having a church that belongs to just your community is something that keeps the community together. The Sao Paulo community, for instance, people used to live around the church, and now people live all over this huge, massive city. But every Sunday, people get together with their fellow Armenians in mass. And so that alone can keep a community together. It keeps young people knowing the language, which is also hugely important. And it's also an incredibly beautiful, the music is beautiful, the mass is, the badarak is really, it's an incredible experience.
This has been a diaspora that's gone on for, I mean, it's been 100 years.
Yeah.
How different and distinctive have the communities become, though, say the large one in Brazil versus one? You have a lot of images here from India, a lot from the United States.
The novelist Aline Ohanessian says, in America, I felt so Armenian, yet in Armenia, I realized I am in many ways an American. And that is the kind of essential issue facing the identity. And of course, people have been affected by their new countries. You can't live somewhere for 100 years, you can't be in exile for 100 years without being affected by the place in which you live. Unless you're in a situation like Lebanon where there are external pressures to keep you apart from the other communities, in this case, the Lebanese Civil War.
Some of your photos from Lebanon really show that sense of community.
Absolutely. Lebanon, there's a village in Lebanon called Anjar that's very special to me. So this picture is from my first trip to Anjar.
Oh yes, this is one of my favorites.
So this is from a henna party. And it's the night before the wedding and the groom is right there. The groom's family throws a party and then kind of midway through the party, everyone walks parades with the musicians. We call this the Davul Zorna. It's the old traditional instruments. And it's this amazing tradition that they've kept. So the backstory with this village is that all of the people in the village are from this area called Musada, which is or Musaler, as we call it. And it's the one place where the genocide has a happy ending. And they were rescued by a French warship because it was right on the Mediterranean. And so everyone lived. I felt very connected to my family in a way that I had throughout the whole project, but hadn't, you know, that was the most connected I had ever felt.
But yet you have a photo in here of some Armenian Americans in LA.
Oh, I love those kids. You have these kids and you have the palm trees and the car. This picture is actually quite controversial within the community. A lot of people have complained about it.
And why?
Well, they say these, you know, they don't look like good Armenian boys. They don't fit the image of what good Armenian boys are. But, you know, these kids are up early in the morning on a Saturday. They got all dressed up. They fixed up their cars because their Armenian identity is important to them. And this is an April 24th march. It's important to them. And
on the anniversary, different anniversary.
Exactly. And so showing this kind of diversity is really a huge part of what this project is.
Now, let me ask you this. Of course, there's this whole controversy about, you know, the genocide and the Turks' unwillingness to call it the genocide and so on. How important is that to members of your generation?
Of course, we think genocide recognition is important in the same way that I think everyone watching this probably thinks Holocaust recognition is important. At the same time, I met hundreds and hundreds of Armenians throughout this project, and I have not met a single person who defines themselves solely by the genocide. You know, it's something that runs through our past, and it is something, it is an important part of our history, but no one thinks that's all we are. I think it's more people in the outside world think, oh, Armenians, the genocide. Yeah. But for us, we know we're more than that.
And that's what you're trying to tell.
Exactly. You know, we are, you know, mothers and children, we are schoolgirls, we are rugby players, we are lawyers, we are, you know, we're just so much more than that, you know?
Well, Scout Tufankjian, thank you so much.
Thank you.